Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all for being patient. I am the last speaker. I am making it very clear there is no more speaker there. So, you know, bear with me for a few more minutes, but it has been fantastic. The timing has been beautiful. I mean, I know if you see my paper, I said 6:30, Rajesh Narayan stops and he stopped. You know, so that beautiful it is going. So, at the outset, let me thank Bangalore branch and Nitin for this great initiative. And I have been observing, you know, the last 3 months that we have been doing programs together, a lot of credits which are the first for Bangalore branch, like a program on companies bill, you did it first, and then you have a concept paper which you have, I mean, a consultative paper which you are doing it the first. So it's been amazingly good to see that, you know, you have a vibrant chairman in Nitin, and it's been working beautiful in the last few months. And as far as today's program is concerned, well, when I was given the mandate to try and structure this program, I ensured that at 3 o'clock in the afternoon there is a lot of fun. So what I did is, the first program I said it is SEBI versus ROC. But it became so bad that ROC came and said, SEBI is my friend. I will not speak anything against SEBI. Then I said, what is this? And I mean, this is not fair, because why I did this is basically 2 years back when I was you know, attending a seminar, and where we had, of course, one of the top officials from SEBI in that session. And I just got up and asked one simple question. Why is there no harmonization between two laws? Please tell me who is big. Is it SEBI or is it MCA? Then, you know, the answer was very simple. SEBI is SEBI. And then he sat down. And that let me, you know, I was just wondering, what is this? I mean, you know, I never got an answer. And he said, yeah, I hope you got the answer. But then I came back and I started working on a paper which is harmonization. I just, what I did is, I took the company law and I took SEBI, I mean the listing agreement, and then I tried to figure out, it was almost 60-70 points which were not syncing with the listing agreement and the company law. Now what has happened? After taking all the feedback, MCA has become smarter. MCA has ensured that they are on top of the listing agreement or the clause 49. And today you find a last 15 page in the consultative paper where it says all this has been mentioned in the company's bill, and we are trying to align clause 49 with the company's bill. It's nice. I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, somebody wins and somebody loses, but it's nice to see that there is harmonization. Now let me also tell you, Anita set the tone. Nita set the tone for the program and she was good. And of course, Sundaresan raised his voice on whatever issues he felt he has to. And I have always fallen in for Ram's voice. It's always that nice, good voice which makes you stand up, think. He left so many things for us to think. Actually, clause by clause, he went on analyzing. And of course, Rajesh Narayan, I wouldn't know if Mr. Seshasayi has ever got it. He was very sarcastic in his comment, but it finally landed up with a message and it has come up. Now the issue is, what do I do? You know, being the last speaker, I have been here for the last 3 hours, hearing you all. There is nothing much for me to say, and nor am I delivering my vote of thanks. I am going to start the presentation. It's not that I am going to let go, you know, because what ROC did not do, I can do. I am a professional, I can be a critic. I can try and push across certain points which, of course, I wouldn't know how much would go through, but there are a lot of points. Few weeks back, we did a program on Companies Bill. Companies Bill introduced 147, sorry, again, I am trying to frighten you with that clause 47, 147, which has listed out all the liabilities for an auditor. Now, while I was hearing this, consultative paper has only one person to nail, and that is independent. So government is very smart, whatever be the legislation, now they are saying, look, you guys as professional take over, whatever is a liability, please face it. So there are amazing liabilities which are coming in, like the last one which he said, related party transaction, if you default, directors have to work. 147, come, Satyam episode one more time, I think some of the big firms will close down because they have to compensate for all the losses that that is going to come up as far as the scam is concerned. So, government is very serious. They are bringing in clauses which are going to protect the stakeholders' interest in the form of huge penalties. Point number one. Point number two, I have always got a very good response from him, you know, one of the most attentive participants I have ever seen. Now, he raised a beautiful point, which is, when Rajesh was trying to tell you on the CS, the NGOs, he said, what is this clause all about? Understand one thing. Government is also very nice. When one door closes, which is no stock option, another door opens. What is that? Now this NGO, for example, I mean, you know, when I was addressing the previous session, I said, quit your audit, take up CSR as a full-time course. No problem, you'll still make more money. Now look at this NGO. What it says, I can still route my money through an NGO which a director has, and that provision has brought it. No, not that I'm giving you ideas, but there is a provision. So look at the government, they just said block stock options, but they opened up a 314, which is the office of place of profit. There's so many avenues. One more avenue is, you become an independent director, form a trust. I wouldn't want to continue. So now, let us look at what, you know, this Clause 49 has in store. If you look at the history, there is only once that Clause 49 has been amended. That is after 6 years, in 2006. Now, one more amendment is coming up, which is again after 6 years. So, once in 6 years, they try to amend Clause 49. Whereas international practice is, every year you are supposed to be reviewing a Clause 49. It is not on a 6-yearly basis or a 5-year plan that a Clause 49 is. It's something which you have to be, you know, abreast of lot of developments and you have to keep correcting it, which is not happening. So, I'm sorry, I'm starting my, you know, praising session. So, you know, first thing, the intervals at which this has been revisited is pretty pathetic, and what they have brought out, I felt, was in a hurry. Oh, Companies Bill has come. Let's put some few people. Let us bring some consultative paper. And then I think something has been introduced. Now, why am I trying to tell you this? Now, with all the speakers covering most of the points which are relevant as far as Clause 49 is concerned, I have to tell you something, right? Now, look at the last 15 pages. The numbering itself is wrong. After 17, straight away 25. There are only 19 points where there is a disconnect between Clause 49 and Companies Bill. Now, if I show you some more data or statistics on this, you will be surprised. There is, whenever I am saying 2.3, it is the consultative paper. So, when the first number appears, please refer to the consultative paper. It is 2.3. It is where they say section 21 of SCRA. What does it say? Delist your company. Which SEBI has never done it in its lifetime because it will affect the larger interest of the stakeholders. The next one which is available is 23E. Now that is where it is a monetary penalty that also, you know, it's history. I mean, not many companies have been prosecuted, nor any promoters have been prosecuted. So basically what are we looking at Clause 49? Is it only a box-ticking exercise, or is it something which is like a quarterly statement that you have to furnish? SEBI takes it, puts it, files it, and then forgets it. I think there has to be radical changes as far as the enforcement of this clause is concerned. Now again, enforcement of the clause. Again, let me take you to Satyam episode. It is said, you know, I mean, it's a joke, of course. SEBI also rushed its officials to take Raju. But Raju was already sitting in a van. That is, economic offenses took him. So basically now, what is happening is it a double jeopardy? I don't know. There is a company law which already has so many penalties, so many enforcement measures. Now there is again a SEBI which is coming in. Again, SEBI is saying, I am also going to punish you. And all of us know a person cannot be tried twice for the same offense. So why two different laws, and why are we trying to, break in one over the other and say, I am big, I am small, this is what it is? No. So good thing would be like, you know, how my friend Sundaresan said, don't worry. Just say wherever company law is applicable, please
go ahead and treat Clause 49 based on the company law provisions. That's it. So there ends the matter. I mean, that doesn't mean that you don't have a conciliatory paper. Again, as I tell you, you know, there are less number of laws, less business for us, and you should have more complications so that, you know, you have business. Now, again, Sundarshan will say, Deloitte signed so many of corporate governance certifications. That's a mandate. So if I let go this, you know, I let go on business. So I'm not saying let it go, but responsibility should be shared. I think on the enforcement, there should be some rationalization and two people should share this load. Look at the next one. 7.2. SEBI can impose stringent conditions than those in the bill. Where is it? When you are never enforced, why do you want to put something in a consultative paper and tell the whole world that Clause 49 is bigger than company law? So, it doesn't happen. Now, look at another thing, which is rule-based in the US versus comply or explain in the UK. Now, what we say, consultative paper, we leave both. We will coin a new word which is called a hybrid approach. Now, I tried to find out what the meaning of this hybrid is. And the meaning that it threw up was so pathetic, you know. It's just implementation that needs to be experimented. No. So, basically, see, when I started reading the paper itself, the third page, these many findings. Then I said, should I roll up the pages and keep moving? I said, yes, let me go and find out. I mean, at least for the sake of all of you, you know. Is there any sync? My topic is harmonization. No? So, I am trying to build some sync into the Clause 49 and Companies Bill. Look at this. 9.5 of the paper says, acclimatized provision of Clause 49 with bill. Now this contradicts with 7.2. 7.2 says, I have the right to impose whatever stringent measures much more than what the bill can provide. The companies will close down because if the penalties are going to be more than the turnovers, where will somebody do any business? So forget it. So companies will as it is tough. Now this fellow is saying that, you know, this to acclimatize, which is not in sync. But my scope of presentation is the last 15 pages. So out of 54 pages, I can still conveniently leave out the 39 and then try to figure out what is there as a harmonization between these two. Look at the analysis. 63% of the provision, this is the last 15 pages, 19 points, analysis says 63% provision says provision in the bill is preferred. 31% says listing agreement is preferred. 6% of the provision are in sync. Now, if you think this is a big number, for your kind information, out of 19, 1 is 6%. So, there is only one which syncs, okay? Don't think that the number game is too big. If I break it into clause-wise, it will still be pathetic. So, 6% is equal to one clause. And you know what that one clause is? Meetings, gap shall not be more than 120 days. This is an achievement of sorts in the entire thing which I read. There is only one achievement, which is there is only one thing which has got a synchronization, which is board meeting gap shall be 120 days. That's it. All these 3 months and 6 months gap and various circulars, nothing. That is one thing which has got perfectly, in sync with the bill. Now, not in sync, which is Clause 49 prevails. When I say Clause 49 prevails, means Clause 49 is better in these respects, which is the composition of the board. Now, having heard the speakers for the last 3 hours, I am not getting into too much of details. Wherever I think I need a pause, I will do that. Next is remuneration of independent directors. That is one of the badly drafted one, which is, again, I have told, but I believe ROC's last statement said it without saying, which is, why did you remove stock options for directors, independent directors? So, I hope all of you were attentive when he said, the bill is already passed. Which means, please don't revisit this subject, just close it. Then, 177.49, which is the Constitution of Audit Committee, it is fantastic. It is much more than what companies bill is, and I think it should be maintained. And then the meeting of AC, which is the Audit Committee also, there is no provision in company law, whereas it is very well laid out in Clause 49. Now, the next one is Companies Bill prevails. which is those clauses where I feel company's bill is better than clause 49, which is again definition of independent director. Again, I mean, there has been lot of debate that particular thing called pecuniary has been, material has been removed and only pecuniary has been left out. Let me tell you one thing. Again, it's company centric, it's individual centric, and I don't think there is anything big for interpretation there. Time tested solution, as I told in the last session also, 10% of the total revenues of the professional still is considered not to be material. 10% of the total professional fee paid by the company, which is billed by the director, is still considered to be not material. So you have to draw a line somewhere, and I think this is what has been prevailing, and this is what will prevail. Next is the tenure of independent director. Again, it has been very well laid out as far as the company's bill is concerned. Again, concerns like the rotation of director or the rotation of auditor will still continue to haunt, but now that it is part of the bill and will become the act, now we will have to work out and think what is to be done basically to counter all these provisions. Now the funniest thing is separation of chairman and CEO. No, it is good. But you know what has happened? Fate of companies which tried to separate the chairman's position and the CEO's position, CEO lost his job. There are three companies in the recent past which has happened. I can't spell it out, but these are all listed companies. Imagine, CEO who was there, who was the founder of the company, chairman who was an independent director of the company, CEO was sent home. Now, don't ask me why, what and all that, but that is the power as far as the chairman, if he's an independent director, is concerned. So the independent directors together can become a cartel, and then there's a threat that the CEO is gone. Now, if you try to customize to Indian solution, I don't think this is a great proposition, because no entrepreneur who has formed the company, who has a sufficient shareholding, will want to separate these two positions. So, good. But how far it is going to be effective, we don't. Next is Remuneration Committee. This is a fantastic provision which is there and which has become mandatory. All this while, you will find a corporate governance report to be something like 12-13 pages, and then you will have some three lines where it mentions remuneration. You will not be given details of how much a managing director or a CEO or a whole-time director is paid, but just a passing remark. Today it cannot be the situation. You need, now these are all UK practices, best practices in the UK which has gotten here, where you will have to list out why you are paying, what you are paying, and is it worth. And things like this are improving. Whether it will become, mandatory, whether companies will fall in line, still to be seen. But one of the good things. Then, as I told you, in sync, you will find only one, which is the meetings. Now, let us look at the preferred clauses, which are good, very good. Declaration of independence. Now, from afternoon, I have been hearing, how will a person prove his integrity? Now, there is a solution, which is like a self-appraisal. All you have to do is write to the board saying that, I have integrity. This is a declaration which you have to give. There is no other choice. So, somebody said, who will assess, what they will assess, how they will assess? He has to give a self-declaration, like how we have today 274(1)(g). You have a declaration by the director which one point will state, I have been honest and I am high on integrity. That's good enough, annual declaration. Now the code of independent director is another very good move. What was optional, what was there, which was hanging in a website in a company, now it has become part, listed company, it has become part of every company. Then you have liability. Clarity on liability of independent directors. According to me, it is one of the most beautiful clauses. Why? Again, previous session, I had referred that there were two circulars which the ministry had brought out which were relating to immunization of the directors. how a director can be immunized, right? So you would have heard from ROC that it is not only it's a immunization process which has come into the bill, which means if the back office, if the housekeeping or the file management of a director is good, independent director, he would not get into problems. Things like don't take things for granted is what is the message I think the ministry is trying to give, and this should find a place in listing agreement also. Then one more thing is like Chundrasekaran, when he was addressing, he said, no, we don't have any clause of auditors in the clause 49. Now I would recommend that the penal provisions or the liability clause of auditors be picked up and put in the clause 49. No, because see, when you are trying to sink it, holistically, where like it was said that the corporate governance certificate 90% are being signed by today audit firms, almost. So why not get the penal provision there? It's a certification. So my takeaway for you on the next is clause 49. What should stay? Again, declaration of independence. This is a repetition. Recommendation. Now let me just quickly close the presentation with a recommendation. Now, having said this, it is not that only the 15 pages that I tried to go through. What was very critical was a clause 11. Which had 31 points, and the 31 points were in the form of a proposal. So what I did is I quickly went through the 31 points and only picked up those which I thought was relevant and may find some change as far as the clause 49 is concerned. One is 11.31. I am coming from the reverse. Enforcement. Please invoke 23E. Penalize the promoters. Penalize the company. Please take action. Why am I saying this? Insider trading has been made a mockery. No. Please understand, it is not that insider trading is not happening. It is happening everyday basis. But then when I went and approached some official and said, why are you not taking action for insider trading? The reply was, very simple. You should have an insider trading policy. If in the insider trading policy, there is a penal provision, SEBI will not interfere. It is like arbitration inside. No? So, what will happen? A director makes about 50 crores of profit. All that the clause should say, penalize the director up to 5,000 rupees. This is what is fact. So, director goes and pays the company 5,000 rupees and then there is a mechanism which gets recorded saying, yes, my director has been penalized. SEBI says good. I mean, why are we letting these people make money? Now, as Neeta said in the morning, what are we trying to do? We are running behind small, mid-sized companies. Whereas big companies are selling, are making company, are giving whatever reasons to put the money. Of course, people are there to make money, but please don't do it under the guise of an insider trading. Please proceed to punish erring directors or promoters under insider trading. I mean, there has to be a mechanism, and this is what I heard. And say, for example, the best of companies has a penalty of 5 lakhs. And that 5 lakhs has to be put in a trust, I believe. That's all. And that trust is run by the CEO. Okay. 11.28. Now this IEPF. Look at IEPF. SEBI is holding or whatever. I mean, he'll get offended. The government is holding 1,000 crores. No, how much of awareness are we creating? Now, company law tries to bring a section whereby there is a penal provision for IEPF. You have to do it, you have to report, you have to remit. Now, the remittance goes and sits. Now, why not seriously go rural and try to educate people? Clause is not at all finding place. It's something vaguely drafted and then let off. Then, 11.27, private participation. This is what Neeta was telling in the morning. The proxy or the afternoon proxy advisory firms. Allow these firms to express. It's okay which way the decision goes, but that was a fantastic point on institutional investors, on people coming and expressing, which is there in 11.27. I have just given an explanation. Next is 11.25, RTP. There is no disclosure whatsoever. We have disclosures in the corporate governance for how many annual general meetings have been held, when it was held, what was done, the list of shareholders, everything. But you will not find disclosures for remuneration committee, you will not find disclosures for related party transaction, you will not find disclosures which directly affect the interest of a stakeholder in the form of monetary. Has any corporate governance report so far reported on an insider trading by a director? This is transparency. Has any corporate governance report come out and said, my director has done insider trading and this is what I have penalized and this is the report? That is transparency. That is when you are educating a stakeholder. And not by putting a small press release in a leading newspaper in some corner and saying, this is what happened. In fact, most of the news doesn't even come out. Next is 11.212324 relating to remuneration and SR committee, which is again, I have told, remuneration committee reporting has to be part of CG report. So CG report has to become more exhaustive in nature. It's okay that three people work for 1 month on a CG report, nothing wrong. But things like remuneration committee, related party transaction, insider trading, violations, put it on. I mean, be open, be transparent. Then 11.20, whistleblower. Everybody knows there is a whistleblower policy. Does a shareholder know what is a whistleblower policy? Has any corporate governance report given you a whistleblower policy on what you should report, how it is being conducted, what is being done? No. So, in the process of trying to bring out too many things and confusing the public, why don't you implement, have a mechanism where you monitor all this and then see that people report. Now, prospectus from a 16-page document in 1993 when I handled the public issue has become a 150 pages or 2000-page document and one disclaimer. SEBI is not responsible for any of the actions that you have taken. So be it. Put the same thing in a corporate governance report. Let the reporting come out. Let the shareholder, whoever wants to read, let them read. But it has to become more transparent. Next, 11.14, separation, I have discussed that. 11.9, remuneration to independent directors, unfortunately nothing can be done, that is here to stay, so it can go. My recommendation was, why don't you try, but after hearing ROC speak saying that bill is a bill, consultative paper is a consultative paper, I have just withdrawn the statement, now I am not recommending also, because I know I am going to fail in that, it's not going to happen. Now, before I leave, as I do for every session, commercial. Like, what do I get? After hearing you for 30 minutes, what do I get? Now, this is what I want to propose. Why is SEBI not using professionals? I'll tell you where I'm coming from. There are about 50 people working in an institution. They have 7,000 companies to monitor. This I have sold even 5 years back to somebody, but nobody was taking, but since he is there and since some consultative paper is happening, why not? These quarterly statements which go and reach them, this, I don't know how many people read inside the system, but it goes and gets punched. If it doesn't get, there is a fax which comes that this quarter we have not received, please send. So you send an apology with the same box ticking saying that, have I complied? Complied. Now, where I am coming from is, now, why don't you outsource this model like a corporate governance certification to the professionals to oversee whether there is compliance? It is not overdoing compliance. Now SEBI in the consultative paper says, we are not bringing out this to add more compliance. Obviously, the compliance that you have, you really need a battery of people to work. Why not? Why not use an external agency to check? Checks and balances. That's about it. That itself will bring lot of healthy things into the system. And with that, I conclude my session and I thank you for a very patient listening. Now what we will do is, we will quickly move over to the panel discussion and I would request Mr. Seshai to come over.